I'm Mo Rocca, and I'm excited to announce season 4 of my podcast, Mobituaries. I've got a whole new bunch of stories to share with you about the most fascinating people and things who are no longer with us. From famous figures who died on the very same day, to the things I wish would die, like buffets. All that and much more. Listen to Mobituaries with Mo Rocca wherever you get your podcasts.
Inspired by the life of the savvy and ambitious Colombian businesswoman Griselda Blanco comes a new Netflix original limited series. Griselda tells the story of a devoted mother who, with her lethal blend of charm and relentless savagery, creates one of the most powerful cartels in history. Witness Sofia Vergara's captivating transformation into the godmother of the underworld. Griselda, now streaming only on Netflix.
Bernigan, ABCs.
Welcome to the Bare Naked ABCs, where we discuss every Bare Naked Ladies song from 7 to Y. And joining us this week, we have Aaron and Jeff. Thank you, gentlemen.
Hello, hello.
Woohoo! Hello, everyone.
And also joining us is a man that I often refer to as Loony, my best friend from college, Stefan.
Over there! Woo!
Good to have you here, Stefan.
Yes, yes.
Good to see you, Stefan.
Good to see you.
Thank you for putting your clothes on today.
Good to see you back in a shirt.
You're welcome.
Much better.
I was going to go a little bit further, then I'm like, nope. Nobody wants to.
It's not often that Stefan comes to these things with pants on, but today he did.
I thought Goodbye Horses was about to start playing.
Well, considering the subject of this week's song, I'm glad that you're wearing clothes.
Oh, goodness.
Me too. Why is that, Tracy?
Aaron, this week's song is Louie Loon. What album is it off from?
Well, this obviously is off of Snacktime. That was a gimme.
What? How did he get that?
That was an easy one for once.
Weird.
Loon, flap your wings, you're picking up speed, soon you'll spring, high above the trees.
Well, it was also off from the album Role Play 2 compilation CD that was done by Sinking Ship Entertainment.
And it was the first single off of Stunt.
That's news to me. Wait, what?
<It was not. laughs>
Yeah. <That's... laughs> Sorry.
No, it was not.
It was not.
No. Stunt would never have ever premiered in the U.S. at that point.
Although, well, I will say.
Oh, my God. No.
The only thing I was going to say is that this is one of the most interesting Snacktime songs, if not the most, that I have heard thus far. I may surprise you guys.
Okay.
Who do you think wrote this song then, Aaron? I mean, the album was easy. Who's the artist that wrote it?
I mean, I'm guessing Paige was at least involved. Cregan?
It was Cregan and Robertson. Music by Cregan.
Okay, I figured... Cregan, there's like a jazzy influence there, and there's some very interesting things with the timing, and we'll talk about that in the breakdown. But
I have to ask the question, though. Did the beaver make you think Paige?
Well, yeah. the beaver and, you know, just some of the vocal stuff. I was thinking Paige.
Okay, just curious.
It's interesting you brought up the beaver. We're coming back to the beaver later.
Leave it.
We always come.
Leave it to Beaver.
We always come back to the Beaver on the
Beaver. We always come back to the Beaver.
Those listening, watch out. The Beavers have.
Our attempts to keep this clean has immediately gone off the rails.
According to Borat, they do.
Keep away from beavers; they might chop your wood.
Aaron, can you give us a breakdown?
I would love to. Yes, thank you. Let's break it down.
Break it down.
All right. So Louie Loon was recorded at 142 beats per minute. It's in the key of A major. We start out with A to D to F sharp minor to D. So we have 1-4-6-1. And this is a little interesting because much more typically you would hear 1-4-6-5 than back to 1. And that is a classic pop rock progression. That you hear in the epic and timeless chorus of More Than a Feeling by Boston, or She Drives Me Crazy by Fine Young Cannibals. Here, however, instead of moving to 5 for the turnaround back to 1, we go to the 4. And as a result, the resolution isn't quite as strong because we're returning to the tonic from the subdominant rather than the dominant. So the song seems a little less in motion, a little more plodding, which is kind of appropriate from a programmatic perspective, since it's a song about a loon just kind of relaxing on the water. Then we have B7 to D to F sharp to G. And I put a little exclamation mark in my notes here, because this would be 2-4-6-7, except for the fact that G natural does not appear in the scale of A major. So for a while, I racked my brain trying to make sense of this as like a temporary key change, but the fact that it happens so fast leads me to interpret the G natural as more of a non-diatonic or borrowed passing chord. This was
definitely a pleasant...
Thank you. I'm glad that you agreed, Steven. This was a pleasant surprise for me, and it pleased like the jazz cat in me. This little walk-up ends back at A, and then we're back to the main progression, A, D, F sharp minor, D. The bridge, again... Sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say, I'd be surprised if it was non-diatonic as well. I mean, it almost renders me catatonic.
So I'm right. That's where you are. I'm still stuck in the fact that Aaron literally just compared Louis Loon to More Than a Feeling by Boston.
No. I know.
It would have been if they had kept the 5 in. It would have been the same chord progression.
You were so close to making this children's song a Boston song.
Right there.
Whoa.
But there's definitely more than a little like jazz DNA in here. And the bridge is interesting. So you have D to E7, E to D, to A, to D, to C, to G, to D, to A, which flows back to our A to D, to F sharp minor to D. So you get this kind of walking... Bridge. What's that?
Looks like the Boston Bridge.
The Boston Bridge. Is that the Tobin Bridge?
Yeah.
So our form is intro.
It's made out of baked beans, ironically.
Yeah, it was baked beans and shellac. I don't know. I was reaching for something non-traditional there. So intro, which is your A changes. Verse 1, A changes, but it's half length. The other verses will be twice the length of this verse. Chorus with your B section, verse 2. Full length, chorus with your B section. That bridge section we mentioned earlier, which is your C, verse 3A. The outro is over the chorus changes, so it's B again. So AAB, AB, CAB. Very, very standard form to the song. But it's deceptive in multiple ways. The transitions between the sections are a little elastic. And even the beginning of the song, I don't know if you guys picked up on this, the song picks up on beat 2. This temporarily drove me insane as I rewound the song and counted through the intro. The leading note of the keyboard line starts on B for beat 1, then moves to C sharp for beats 2, 3, 4, and stays on C sharp for beat 1 of the next measure, and then comes back down to B for beats 2, 3, and 4 of the next measure. But since the song starts on beat 2, you're thinking, oh, okay, you got 4 beats of C sharp and then 4 beats of B. And you're counting like 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. But then the drums come in, and all of a sudden you're off. You're completely off beat. So I have experienced this phenomenon before with other songs, but this feels like it was done intentionally, which I think they're having a little fun with the listener. So again, perhaps being programmatic to an extent, as of course Loon is both the name of the national bird of Canada, and it's on their $1 coin. But also a word to describe someone who is loony. So it's a little off kilter. It's a little different. This whole song has like tiny little unique details that kind of make it interesting to me. I'm a little angry in retrospect that I gave a high-ish rating to other Snacktime songs now, because if I'd known there was something this excellent on that album, I probably would have stuck to being relatively harsh for the other kids' songs. This is great. I unabashedly really like this song.
Huh.
Surprise reaction from the peanut gallery.
No, I actually agree. I love this song. I think the sound of the song, the acoustics of it are really solid. The harmonies in this are fantastic. It sounds It sounds way better than you would expect it to come off. It's a very chill, very pleasant song to describe its subject matter. And like you mentioned, I mean, it's obviously paying homage, even though it's a kid's song, it's paying homage to, you know, a well-known Canadian figure, the Loon. And when it hits that bridge, especially, like, that's it just it really melds together beautifully. It's a really good song.
Yeah, usually when the Loon hits the bridge, it dies.
But no, but I just mean sonically. This is a really good song.
Just saying.
Yeah, I agree. I think, you know, the vocal harmonies are really beautiful. The banjo playing
spot on,
is excellent.
Yes.
And the interplay
yeah.
between the banjo and the guitar and the keys is quite wonderful.
Yeah, I love the bluegrass feel to this. I've always been a big bluegrass fan, and like this one just sounds very natural. It's a great song. I would enjoy this, and my kids would enjoy it. And that's, you know, that's what a kid's song, you know, that's what we want out of a kid's song. You want a song that you can play in the car that your kids are going to like, but you're also going to be like, I'm perfectly cool with this being on. And this song fits that criteria.
Surprised by the song.
Aaron, you may have brought this up because I'll be honest, I was trying to keep up with what you were saying with all the different key changes. I mean, all the different chord changes through there. One of the things I found interesting musically that they did in the middle of verse two, they all of a sudden in the middle of verse two, for whatever reason, do this change where they break away from the chord structure. They break away from the verse structure that's going on. And all of a sudden it's where they say, June the Beaver, below you'll leave her. And then it goes back to gnawing on sticks again.
Soon you'll spring.
Soon you'll spring.
High above the trees. June the Beaver. Below you'll leave her. Gnawing on sticks.
Gnawing on sticks.
With another dam to fix.
Like, it's this little breakaway, almost like mini bridge that happens in the middle of verse two. And it hasn't happened in the middle of any of the other verses.
Yeah, that's what I was referring to earlier when I said, like, the sections, the transition between them are kind of elastic. And it's deceptive because you just listen to it without really kind of trying to analyze it or think about what's going on. And it's just a simple little tune, but... Frequently this will happen where I'll hear something and then depending on how I approach it, sometimes I'll just listen to it without trying to critically analyze it. This one, I for whatever reason, I was like no nonsense and I just dived immediately into like analyzing it. And like I said, it kind of drove me batty or loony for a little bit because... it was harder to follow than the simplicity of the song would lead you to believe. So yeah, it was interesting. Definitely, it's the kind of song that, well, you know, you hit the nail on the head earlier. We talked about how, or I think Jeff said, you know, children can enjoy it, but their parents can enjoy it too. It's like when they put like adult jokes into kids' movies or whatever that they will go over the kids' heads. It's a lot like that, where like it. You can appreciate it on multiple levels. And, you know, as far as lyrically speaking, aside from the possible beaver joke, I don't think there's too much else going on there. It's pretty straightforward. But or actually, I'd be kind of curious to see if you guys had anything else to add to that. But, yeah, I mean, just musically speaking, it's deceptive and it's very enjoyable. I like it.
Jumping around, I mean, lyrically, it's a solid song too. I mean, it does hit on a cute little. I mean, it sticks to that ABAB, you know, for the verses. Very solid down water around otters, which is cool. The wing speed spring trees. I mean, they're half rhymes, but it's definitely lyrical imagery, which works for this song, which is what it should be. I love the lyrical painting on the bridge though. She hears your song echoing over lakes and hills, lonely and long. Sometimes it's high, sometimes it's a trill. They sneak that little switch up on the rhyme scheme there with wherever you are, you're admired from afar. So they give you that little AA, which I think is really cool. Just around the bend, you can always call your friends. So they give you a little bit of an AAB, delayed B rhyme scheme. So the writing there is really sneaky too, but it works. It's really great. I really do love kind of the painting they're doing lyrically in the song. It's one of those that you kind of get carried away with, and it feels good.
Well, one of the things that they do in this song as well that we haven't mentioned yet is the echoing, which for Loon calls is very programmatic, because Loon calls are known to
right.
be very echoey yeah. and to echo off the mountains right. around the lakes. And I like that they incorporated that into the song in a lot of ways as well.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I agree.
Yeah, because the harmonics are always kind of an echo. Yeah.
You know, I'm looking at the beaver part, and you know, I'm not sure if that is a joke, but I suppose based on the lyrics, I suppose it could be translated as something that's more adult related, but yeah, I don't see it right off.
You mean that June the Beaver is gnawing on sticks? What?
Well, that's what beavers do. They gnaw on sticks. So, I mean, you know, I'm a simple guy, I guess, but I mean, and I can have a mind just as dirty as the rest, I guess, but I don't see it. But it's the below you'll leave her. Yeah, you don't want to touch what's down below. That's for sure. You leave it. You leave it alone. It's got teeth. It'll gnaw your stick off. It's bad. Bat. It's a beaver trap. You stay away from that thing.
Yes, beavers are a dangerous animal. Children.
All right, enough about the damn beavers.
Yeah. Is that in reference to a diaphragm? Oh my God. You might have to edit that one out.
No, he was just talking about when do you project with your vocals. You breathe through your diaphragm.
Yes.
You got it. Oh, thank you, Joe. I really appreciate that.
Yeah, Joe Bob Briggs here.
Joe Bob, we know you listen. Please come on the show. Please.
I will have to say, though, guys, I'm going to disagree with you about the lyrics on this song, though.
Oh, really?
Oh, what?
Find this song wanting when it comes to the lyrical piece.
Do you really? Is it the splash, 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 splash?
No.
That does it for you? Is
I
that
like that.
Not creative enough?
No. I find it a very poetic song.
What is the trouble, Tracy?
It's not
yeah, please.
Educational. Like, there are other songs that we will get to
Whoa, come on. Whoa.
Let me finish.
You got two Keanu Reeves reactions to that.
Let me finish.
Boo! Whoa. Boo! Sorry, go ahead.
There is a much more educational song that is on this album, also written by Jim, that is much more educational.
La, 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 la.
About an animal. Okay. And I think it's a much better song.
I think it's La, 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 Llama.
Is this song poetic? Yes. Is it? But I don't think it tells us anything beautiful, anything about this beautiful bird. The beautiful plumage, for example. It's got a very distinctive call, both the regular cry and the male cry. Like, so if you listen to this song, most of the things that it tells you in this song about this bird could be true about a goose, could be true about ducks, could be true about swans. Like, all these things that it's mentioning, it does not mention the beauty of what a loon is. And I mean, this is a bird that is majestic enough that it is the state bird of Minnesota. It's the provincial bird of Ontario. It is the Canadian national bird. It's on the $1 bill coin in Canada. It was on the $20 bill. It's on the Minnesota state quarter. Like, this is,
and man, do they taste good.
I don't know. I think you're being a little harsh, Tracy.
If I
wrote a song about the bald eagle, and I love the way that you soar majestically in the sky, would you be like,
"Well, and I love the sound you make"? Tracy, what is the best what is the best children's musician of all time?
Weird Al Yankovic.
I would say besides him, Weird besides Al, him. But then Rick Charette, or I would say
Stephen Lynch.
What about Raffi?
Raffi.
Banana phone, banana
what about
phone?
Shel Silverstein? What about Shel Silverstein, okay. Who's also a musician? Okay.
The Wiggles?
Are all their songs the Wiggles? Are all their songs educational?
Not all of them, no.
No, and many of them aren't. But they're fun for kids. They're fun for adults. They paint an image. Sometimes that's all it takes. They don't have to teach you something. A children's song does not have to teach you something.
I feel like it just has to give you. Like this, a loon to me, the loon is a very special. I love loons.
Oh my God!
I love loons.
But this is a song like trying to spread.
The trouble with Tracy is they didn't teach you enough about
Tracy,
loons.
We have songs about snacks, and we have songs about funny words.
Well, yes, but
Tracy
love them.
Sound like Brick from Anchorman. I love Loon.
As we will get to with Pollywog in a Bog, it could, like, I feel like this song had the opportunity to lift.
It's like Tracy listened to Hello Mutter, Hello Fodder and said, where's the mess hall? You didn't tell me anything about where the damn mess hall
exactly.
is.
Exactly.
I do not understand the layout of this camp at all.
What is a mother?
I felt like this song could have lifted loons up and taught kids about the majesty of the loon.
That's right. The loon lives, matter.
Amazing animal that we don't learn anything about from this song. There's not tons of interesting things about Loon.
She has a song. It echoes over lakes and hills. It's okay. Lovely and long.
I will say the bridge.
Sometimes it's high. Sometimes it's high, Tracy. Hey, Tracy. Sometimes it's high. Sometimes it's trill.
Yeah.
I learned something about the call.
The bridge is, I will say, the best part educationally about this song.
It's spotted like a Dalmatian.
We spend a whole verse talking about June the Beaver when we're talking about Louie Lou.
I've been on this show now for, 2 years? And the
long.
Worst battle we're ever going to have
too long.
Is Louie Lou.
I mean, so obviously, Tracy, we're all kind of busting your chops a little bit, but I am legitimately surprised because you have vehemently defended so many of these children's songs from my vicious attacks, and now I feel like I'm the one, the only one on my side is the blood-sucking lawyer.
I love loons, and I feel like they were given a disservice with the song. Like, it is a poetic song, but it is not tell me anything about loons and why they're different from any other bird, and I wish they had. Like, loons are monogamous. They are the only bird that are fed by both parents. The chicks can dive underwater within a few days of being born. They swallow most of their prey underwater. They are one of the best fishers that's out there. They have numerous myths with the Native American and First Nations groups about how they were part of creating the world. Like, all of these are interesting, cool things. They're the way that they look, they're singing, the fact that they go, that they are able to actually track down fish underwater and catch fish underwater, which very few birds can actually do. Most of them dive down from the air and will catch fish. The loons actually can swim underwater for 45 to 60 seconds to actually catch up to the fish and hunt them down under the water. Like, it.
How fast can they swim, Tracy?
They clocked the T-Rex at 30 miles per
hour. I don't know how fast they can swim, but they can fly up to 75 miles an hour. Like,
so that was all fascinating, and legitimately, I'm glad that you that was all really, really cool. And I kind of agree, like, it'd be nice to have some interesting facts about the loon in the song. But allow me to undermine your argument in the style of Jeff Goldblum, as I've been making Jurassic Park references, Chaos Theory, Butterfly Flaps Its Wings.
Just because you could make that song doesn't mean you should.
A Canadian rock band makes a song about the loon. And years later, you have this group of podcasters, and one of them spouts off a bunch of interesting facts about the loon. Now you've got these fans of the show. They're listening to it, and they're learning these facts because of that song. If they hadn't written that song, they would not have listened to this podcast, and they would not have listened and learned those wonderful facts. So this song has led, indirectly, I'll grant you, to the education of listeners who now know those really, really interesting loon facts. I rest my case.
I am going to counter that argument with one thing, and this is my last and final argument. This song would have been made so much better by just having the loon in the background.
Like the little loon call?
Yes. Just adding that that mournful, mysterious, haunting loon sound in the background during the song would have elevated the song.
I just listened to a song recently from a guy who actually took like a cat meow and he looped it into like some kind of funky song, and it was pretty awesome. I mean, they could have done like a loon call in some kind of loop and made it awesome, but
they
like to add stuff
like that into songs all the time.
Sergeant Pepper's Beetle loopy kind of thing.
Yeah, we don't bring up the Beatles on this show.
Well, just the Beavers.
Just the Beavers, yes. And the Monkees.
Jeff, you get the best you get the best one for right now. I
okay, all right.
Points for that one.
What? No love for Debussy?
Actually, all of the puns that you guys have been putting up there have been phenomenal so far. I have been watching.
I also appreciate your loon thesis. I thought that
no,
was good.
Yeah, legitimately.
Oh.
So, but no, I really did. Like, I went down a deep dive this week, kind of finding out more about the loon, and I really love it. And it really has been a bird that for a very long time has had a lot of respect in my eyes, because watching them on the lakes they are just beautiful.
So, Tracy, I made a quasi-facetious counter to your argument earlier, but allow me to make that a similar argument, but quite seriously now. Because of this song, you went down a wiki rat hole and learned a bunch of stuff about loons. Did this song not lead you to learning about loons?
I will give you
Could
that
you argument. Not see a kid listening to this song and be like, yeah, you know what? I know the loons are a national bird or you know, whatever, or they might be in the world. I'd like to learn more about them. I think it could be like this, you know, sometimes the best way to educate someone is just kind of get them interested in a topic and let them go and find out for themselves. Inception.
Yes.
That's how arch villains are also made too. Through great disappointment, you know, there's some kid out there listening to the song right now saying my life, you know, is
one out of 10.
Exactly.
More facts.
Exactly. And you know, they're like, I wish I had the Infinity Gauntlet with all the stones. You never know, man. It's like,
by
he's
the way,
up there.
I would not leave it to chance that Jim actually put the beaver in the song about a loon as a chance. When I was doing research about this in the backstory, I find it interesting. In the Mi'kmaq and Wabanaki stories, which those are the Native American First Nations people in this area, the
in
beavers,
Maine.
There was a story that the beavers had actually dammed up the river, and the loon was known to call up was used by the tribe to call up Glooskap, who was the hero of a number of their stories, who came and destroyed the dam so that the salmon could swim up river again. They threw the beaver, and where the king beaver landed, it became Sugarloaf Mountain. So, I
Tracy, why did you do that research?
Because the song.
Because the yes. song. So because you heard the song, you felt compelled to then go learn more, correct?
Yes. Now, my
so
point is, I think
because
the
song,
that,
this song had just enough of a tidbit of an yes. idea, you then felt compelled to go and research and learn
Yes, the more. Witness will answer counsel's questions, please.
But my
so
point
like a
is
child,
that I think
a
that
child
Jim,
listening to the song going, why would that be in there? I may need to find out more. Yes. Have we not talked
to
the child?
I think that Jim may have actually known that and put that in the song for that reason.
I guarantee he did, because I just looked it up. It's a pretty well-known Canadian fact.
So it's kind of neat that he did put that in there.
Right, to then encourage children to go learn more. Yeah.
No,
right, because why tell kids everything when you can encourage them to go broaden their horizons. So instead of just giving them your second grade thesis on the loon,
so here we go. Here's my simile. It's like episodes 4, 5, and 6, you know, it left a lot of room for imagination. And then comes along 1, 2, and 3, which is like, miso shasha beats, miso stupid, you know?
Why are we talking about Terminator?
Yeah, it's horrible. Leave room for imagination. And then there's Tracy saying something about Terminator, which is not related to anything I was saying.
Luke, I am your father.
Get to the chopper!
Well, you know what? Okay, so we've had my say. Why don't we have the kids say? Why don't we have them decide what they think about this song?
I agree.
I think that's what we need, yes. Let's hear what the kids have.
Okay. Yeah, but we already had Tracy speaking.
Okay, Isabella. So tell me from your perspective, from a kid's perspective, what you thought about this song.
I like how at the start it describes it a lot. So it's like I'm actually there.
Were there any things about the song that you didn't like or that you would change?
No.
Can you tell me what you would give this for a number as a kid? What do you think? 0 to 5?
4.9.
It's all out of love. That one.
Okay, Jeff, so the kids have had their thoughts. What do we want to rank this song on as the adults?
Oh. You know what? I didn't come up with a good one for this one.
All that time.
How about Loon Facts?
Loon Facts. Loon Essays. How many Loon Essays do we want to rank this on?
I had that coming.
I think it should be on Loon Essays. A 0 to 5 Loon Essay.
It's in there. Hey, Essay, who's going first?
Loon Essay.
Who's going first?
Let's do Stefan first.
All right. Well, sorry, I just got inundated with this cat. Hold on. I like the music to it. It's really good. I mean, I'm a fan of some of the Snacktime songs because it's super simple. They actually have some really good music that accompanies some of these songs. And it's just really, really surprising. So, I think what I'm going to do is rank this a good solid 3 for the song. Maybe even 3.2. Let's say 3.2 because the music's great. The lyrics are simple. And they sing Louie Loon in the background to the point where I can't even tell they're saying Louie Loon. It just sounds like a cool noise in the background that goes with the song. So I think that's kind of really cool. So, so I'm going to stick with that, about 3.2.
3.2?
Yes.
Respectable. Nice. Aaron, lunacy. Lunessay.
I will share some lunessay with you. In fact, I have a loon fact for you guys. Tracy, I don't know if you came across this during your research, but... a group of loons is called a water dance. Mm. I think that's interesting.
That is poetic. Interesting. Almost like something that could go in this song.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Like when he's referring to all his friends. Like, not letting this go.
I went to the high school water dance. But yeah, so...
Was that the enchantment by the sea dance?
By the sea. Might be a little advanced for you guys, but your kids are going to love it. as usual, vocal harmonies are beautiful. There's some pretty bells on the outro. The whole thing's very tranquil and very pretty song. Let it not be said that Aaron does not like happy songs or upbeat songs. I do like this one a lot. And as you guys know, I'm here for two reasons, and that is to analyze the music and to make They Might Be Giant references. I could hear They Might Be Giants playing this or something like it.
Oh, yeah.
Very, very, very cool. Very, very, very interesting musically. And like I said, there's stuff going on just beneath the surface of the water, which makes it really extra interesting to me.
Where they dive deep exactly. Down. Which is, by the way, a fact I learned about loons listening to the song.
I learned.
I had no idea that loons.
I would not have known that a group of loons was called a water dance unless we had this conversation. Listen to this song. So,
look at all the knowledge we learned about the song just by listening to the song.
I feel like the Russian lady at the end of Crystal Skull. All the knowledge is filling me up. But anyways, in all seriousness, I really did like this song. This is probably my favorite song. I haven't looked at all the ratings I gave the kids' songs. You know, every once in a while, I'm feeling gregarious. I gave like Deck the Stills like a 3.95 or something. I liked it a lot though. I'm not sure it's in my best of playlist, but it's actually pretty close. And I'm going to give Louie Loon 3.85 Loon Essays out of 5. I think it's very solid.
Cool.
Nice. Awesome. I'm going to go next before we get to the haterade, who didn't learn enough about loons from the song. I do like this song a lot. I thought it was a good one for a kids album. And like Aaron said, I could hear this on, like, you know, Here Comes Science, you know, like They Might Be Driving Something. Musically, it's beautiful. It does some really crazy little things in there that you're not expecting. The harms are tight. You know, lyrically, I do like it. Just going off you, and not to beat on what Tracy said, but I don't think a kid's song does have to always be educational. It just has to feel like we want to, harm you with harms. We don't always have to teach kids something. We can teach kids to appreciate something. And if this song, I think, teaches kids to appreciate good music, good artistic painting, good lyrics, good word painting. I think there's a lot. And I think it does want you to... I gotta stop looking at Aaron's screen during this thing. It does teach you to... I don't care, Aaron. It does teach kids to, I think, pursue things further. So I do love this song a lot. I would play this. I would play this in the car with the kids. I would enjoy it. I gave this one a 3.7 Lunasays. Lunasays?
Nice.
So, Tracy?
3. What?
You want a 3.7.
Oh, yeah.
Tonight, Tracy will be drinking the blue haterade.
You want to bring the score down now?
I'm going to bring the score down now. No, I know that I've been harsh on this song tonight, and I get that. It is a fun song, though. It is delightful. It is a beautiful song to listen to. And even though it's not educational, as I was saying before, it's a story song, and that's what I think it's meant. That's where I was trying to go, is that it is more of a story song than an educational song that we get with some of their other songs on this album. That being said, I still enjoy it. We're going to discuss a much more educational tune later on this year about nature, but that's not what this song was really meant to be. And I think that it does very well what it's doing. It's not a song that I would seek out. So for that reason, I'm going to give it a 3.
Wow, okay.
Oh.
All righty, then.
3.
But, by the way, speaking of learning things, I just had to look up what gregarious meant. Yeah, because Aaron said that, so...
It's one of my favorite adjectives.
He's a good guy, that Greg.
That Greg Arias.
Yeah.
He was on Game of Thrones, wasn't he?
He's very porous.
Gregarious.
Yeah, he's very porous. He's very Arias.
Yeah.
You know who else is gregarious? The person that we were possibly going to have on tonight, but actually isn't on, but is our appearance for this week, is two videos of Zach Daniels playing on stage with B&L on the Ships and Dips 4 tour, and they're playing this song. Nice. So that's the appearance for this week.
Didn't he play with Charlie?
No, he didn't play with his brother Charlie, no.
Gotcha.
Yeah. So he did go down to Georgia.
Yes. Oh. Well, actually, Florida, and then they took the cruise ship from Florida.
The devil went down to Florida. He was looking for a ship to cruise on.
A ship to steal.
He was retiring.
He was feeling mean because his donut had baked beans.
Oh! I do not love
bringing it back.
A donut with baked beans. I do not love it at all. But next week, I'm going to love the song that we're... No, we're not. No, I'm not.
No, we're Let's not. Be honest. That was a bad intro.
Yeah. No.
Come on.
Now but I'm next curious. Week, we're going to discuss. We're going to talk about love. We're going to talk about the love that we're in.
No, we're not. Love stinks. Yeah, yeah.
Jeff, I get it. Okay. You don't need to make fun of my puns, you know? It could Sorry. Be the last time that I make puns, and you would never want to throw that away.
Yeah.
I would not.
Never so it's the not. Song last time?
So next week, we're going to be discussing the love that we're in.
The love that we're in.
Oh, you mean all of us?
Yes.
Because we're pretty close.
I sure hope Tracy learned something from this song.
Yeah, I know.
I'm learning nothing from next week's song.
Not enough love facts for me. Do you guys know that oxytocin is actually responsible for the love response?
Come back next week and we'll see if it's an educational song. Maybe it's on the Snack Time album.
Maybe. Is it about the birds and the beavers?
Swallowing those sticks.
Oh, jeez.
Well, that's what beavers do.
Well, see, Jeff.
They swallow sticks.
Jeff, they swallow the sap in sticks. They chew on the sticks and swallow the sap.
Oh, so they basically chew on the stick until the sap comes out.
Yes.
Stop.
They start the bass and gnaw on the way up.
Well, folks, we've had a good run here at the Bare Naked ABCs. It's been a pleasure.
Now we're getting into a different sort of educational discussion.
Hey, it might prevent pregnancies.
Oh, jeez. We went from innuendo to just straight down the pike.
Sorry, that's me.
So, send your opinions.
Thanks, that was fun. Don't forget, no regrets, except maybe one.
To celebrate joining Pantheon Podcasts, Rock Camp, the podcast, the official podcast of Rock and Roll Fantasy Camp, is giving away a guitar signed by Mike Portnoy of Dream Theater, Marty Friedman, formerly of Megadeth, and legendary shredder Zakk Wylde, plus our rock star counselors like Vinny Appice, Monty Pittman, and more. To enter to win, simply follow, rate, and review our podcast on your preferred platform, and that's all you have to do. For more information, go to rockcamp.com/podcast.